So hello again and welcome along to another Mindburner video. Today we're looking at the Aelita synth, which is a Soviet synth built in the mid 80s, and this one has a bit of damage to it, needs a repair and needs a Midi kit installed. So stick with me while I go through the procedure. So here we have the Soviet era Aelita synthesizer, quite an impressive looking machine. Lots of really cool sort of knobs and buttons on it, you know, it's quite a colourful effort. I think it looks really amazing, very heavy and solid. Now this one's had a bit of an injury and some of the keys are raised up here, so I'll have to sort that out as well. I think it maybe fell off or something like that. It is a very heavy synthesizer and a little bit unstable. It has this kind of knob here which locks in the top panel. I'm not sure if that goes fully down, but it's sort of mini MOOC style. So I've had this for a while and I haven't put the MIDI kit into it yet because it's a bit of a beast and I've just been a bit sort of put off by the complexity of taking this thing apart. So this is just a panel of the underside. Looks like a fuse holder there. It's quite a lot of screws, so I'm just going to start taking screws out and see what happens. So I'm just trying to take this apart here and wedging the bass out gradually, which seems to move this keyboard assembly. So I'm just not 100% sure how this all comes out, but you can see that that's kind of moving there. There's probably more screws. Take out, there's bits of things falling out of it as I open it. It's just really, you know, odd. So you do have to remove these screws here on this sort of, looks like an ADSR panel or something. Take those out. There's two of those, a star head, everything else is slotted flat blade, so they come out also. This should, yeah, it's made it a little bit looser now, but these, you have to watch, these are coming off, so put those somewhere safe. It's red, grey. So I've loosened all the screws, including one over here on this side, and this should hopefully all come away, and it does actually quite nicely now that it's been separated. And it's got a couple of big umbilical kind of cord jubbies here. Don't know if you can see those in the shot, but they're, you know, MIDI cables joining the controller section to the circuit board, and it's pretty cool. So I'll just switch over to the camera here and show you the circuit board properly. So we have a transformer on the left, large smoothing caps, and then a power supply of sorts with, these must be heat sinks. Quite a, you know, Soviet looking industrial piece of kit. Quite impressive. And then this must be the voice board over here. Looking over here at the voice board, just panning along the ICs, they're all Russian. KT. And then there's like a lot of diodes over here, possibly for the keyboard. So nicely laid out. And I think these are probably op amps and stuff like that. Just haven't got the spec on them yet, but nothing socketed, so if something goes wrong you're into a desolder job. So as far as I know, this machine functionally works apart from the dodgy keyboard. So what we're going to do today is put a MIDI kit into it. So first of all, I'm just going to check that the synth works before I do anything else. I've just connected a little Bluetooth mini speaker here via 3.5mm jack into the back to get some audio out and turned it on. Notice that the volume control actually sort of works in reverse, with 0 being at the top and 10 being at the bottom. So when your volume's down, as it were, it's actually up. Sort of a Soviet thing, I guess. So it does make some sound, not in all the keys, certainly at the lower ones, just these upper ones. There is a lot of these sort of broken bits of keys, which maybe are from the back of this, all inside. So this is maybe from when the machine was had an accident. So that must be the individual oscillator tuning, 1, 2 and 3, so that's sort of centre. So this thing is quite a nice sound. It's kind of sort of accordion sounding type thing, but you know, it definitely could be used, especially sampled or something like that, and be very useful. So I just don't have anything in the lower part of the keyboard here. hopefully a MIDI kit will, you know, restore functionality to this, as well as hopefully I'll be able to get this keyboard working. Okay, so I'm just gonna lift the keyboard out here and see what way it is. It's sort of hard to disconnect it here, but hopefully you can sort of see these keys here. Yeah, the bits that actually go onto the J wires are completely snapped off, so there's nothing to hold this, these keys down, which makes them pop up. So I don't want to damage this any further, so I'm trying to be a bit careful with it here. But I'll probably have to then try and glue these things on here on these keys, these white keys, and hopefully reconnect them to J wire and get that part working. Why the keys at the bottom aren't working, I'm not too sure. So I'll have to investigate that further. So here's just a clear shot of the keyboard and the damage. So this should be attached here to the bottom of the keys and then go through these J wires. I've only been able to find 5 of these stems and there are 6 affected keys. So I don't know where the other one's gone. It could have maybe fallen out one of the sort of openings in the synth, of which there are a couple. So that could mean a new key really for this, but I'm going to try and repair it as best I can at the minute by gluing these in. So essentially what needs to happen is that this needs to be glued on here so that when the key goes down, the little green base, you know, bushing there hits against the bottom of this. But you don't have a lot of area to glue it to. You've really just got like a U-shaped area around the edges. I tried, you know, super glue there, but doesn't work on this old plastic, you know. So I don't know what to try really, maybe some sort of epoxy. But really the ideal solution would be to get new keys for this. Well, probably quite hard to get. So to fix some of these keys, I've just tried to remove them. So what you do is you just use a little tool, like a spudger or something, or screwdriver. I have this little curved tool, which is kind of nice, to take the springs off like you would in a regular keyboard. Now one thing to watch is there's a little bar up here which goes through and secures the top of the spring to the key. That can easily get lost and fall out. So just be careful with that. But once you do that, you can then just lift the key out and you can see that one is broken. So we'll need glued. So that's the key glued and hopefully it's a good job. The only glue I had was this, which is for mobile phones and stuff like that, to glue the cases back together. So it seems fairly strong, but epoxy might be better, and I've some ordered, so when I get that I'm going to do the rest of the keys. So what's this weird contraption on the left? Well, it's supposedly a sort of version of the broken shaft of the key, and I made it out of an old circuit board. So it's a wee bit wide, so I just have to trim it off on the left hand side, but it should do the same job, and I've glued it in here. So because I can't find this bit that's broken off, I'm going to use this sort of bodge and hopefully it'll work okay. See, it's buying a new key. It's even got a hole in it, roughly in the same place for the J wire, but I may have to drill another hole, I'm not too sure. So here we have the Frankenstein key in place now. You can see it sort of works. So just have to go and clean the contacts a wee bit in this synth, but you know, I'm quite pleased with that. So I'm now ready to fit the MIDI kit. So one of the first things you need to do is to check the power supply and to check that the 5V that the MIDI kit relies on is reliable and within range. So you get an earth and then go to the center pin here on this connector, according to the instructions. I don't know if you can see that, but it's 3.8, so that's kind of low. So there's an adjuster R4, which I'm going to tweak now, and that should bring it up to 5V. It's on the power board. So here's the trim, roughly in the middle of the shot, R4. This is what you need to tweak to get the voltage in 5V. So I'm going to do that now. So that was a little dodgy there, but I managed to get it into 5V. So that's changed the tuning of the whole thing up a little bit, as you would expect. So again, we have a good instruction sheet for MrLogic here. This is a PDF he kindly sent me to fit this, and you can see that the ground connection and the 5V connection are clearly marked here. So that's the first thing I'm going to do. So here's a little Korg SQ1 connected up. It's a bit of a beast. So after getting the machine perfect, put together, all playing, all working, left it on for half an hour, came back and the machine wouldn't do anything but buzz like this. And it turns out, taking it apart again, the power supply has dropped away down, it's like 3.5 volts. It sort of still works in the top keys, bottom keys have stopped working for some reason. The thing isn't putting out the right voltages, like on pin 1 it should be, I think, minus 10. And then it should be 5 volt in pin 4. It's something like 8, minus 8 and minus 3. Now the buzzing could be these capacitors dried out. So the power supply is going to need a real looking at, like. New capacitors for sure. And possibly could be regulators or something else wrong with it. So that's a real shame, you know, it got so far. But it sort of started buzzing randomly. And then when it came back, it's just like this. So the first order of the day is to desolder these capacitors. They're 500, they're marked, which is going to be a 470. I'm not sure the voltage reading, but you know, maybe 50 volt or something there. Maybe, it's hard to see the markings, but I'm going to take these three out anyway. And these capacitors are probably okay. So I would suspect the smoothing capacitors as well here, these big cans, need to go. And you know, probably well dried out, but now the real beastie things, you know, you can see underneath there, they're kind of bolted in. So I may just mount capacitors on the underside here. So I thought I'd just check one of the cans here, see what we get on the meter. Oh, so it's actually reasonably good, you know. The capacitance is too high there at 613, but ESR is pretty decent and the loss is pretty decent, so yeah, don't think this is the cause of the problem, but you know, could do with being replaced. I hope you can see that on the camera, but number 3 capacitor is pretty bad, 22% there, and 774 for a 500 capacitor, so that's definitely worth changing. So just a quick look at the underside of this. These are the cans I've already soldered in or connected in. So they're going to be mounted properly. These are the ones to be replaced. So rather than trying to desolder these, I'm just cutting the wires here and, you know, joining them on to the new caps. It's a wee bit of work, like. So, you know, you just have to make sure you get them right. So that's the positive in the center. Try to keep the original little markers on there if I can, just for... That's the center wire, and then just adding in a good quality Panasonic 4725 volt. So I believe there are 25 volt as well, so that should be okay. So here we have all the capacitors now done, and they're reasonably neatly done. So I just have to secure those in some way, probably a cable tie around them, then through these holes. Possibly could mount them through the hole in some way, but if it's just underneath, it'll be fine. Well, and what do you know, hum be gone. Certainly a lot better. So if you have a lot of hum on your synth, it could well be the smoothing capacitors, or very probably is. Of course, we all know that if we're into synths, we all know the power supply capacitors take a bit of a beating over the years, and they do dry up and go out of spec. Especially in some of these Soviet synths, you know, the capacitors I don't think are as good quality as maybe the Japanese capacitors were, and something like a Roland, you know, SH2 or something like that. So I'm just going to check the 5 volt rail here. Hopefully it's risen a bit. Well, yeah, risen a big bit, 6.58, so that's brilliant. So a bit of headroom. And now drop that down to the correct 5 volt. Now this pot's a bit dodgy here, but I think around about 5. You know, 5.02, that's pretty good. Thanks a lot for watching the video, and I hope you've enjoyed it. Stick around for more videos and subscribe and like, and I'll see you next time.